Hello viewers, welcome to another special episode of the Big Leap from Mirae Asset. We are very happy today to have with us Mr. Ajay Ladha from Otus Wealth Management from Pune. Ajay sir has been in the business for now almost 18 years. He started the firm in 2002 talking about wealth management. One of the key factors about when we look at Otus is it has been probably one of the first wealth management setups to have a very strong independent research team, and that has been one of his hallmarks, that he would do his own research about asset classes and products before talking about it to his clients. Otus today manages almost 800 plus families, managing wealth for them and the first and second generation investors. And about Ajay sir, what is very interesting is that more as a wealth manager, he's a very avid traveler. He probably almost travels 100 days in a year. He treks in the Himalayas almost every year. He cycles through one or two countries almost every year. And that is one of the interesting part of Ajay sir's repertoire in terms of travel. The whole Otus team almost travels once a year as a team. So other than wealth management and money, this is one part of Ajay sir we would like to touch upon. So welcome Ajay sir. Thank you so much for doing this. This is some interesting things which we wanted to share with our viewers about you and Otus. But let's start with you. How did Otus started?
Yeah. So my father used to be the chief financial officer of Bajaj Auto, and he also set up Bajaj Finance and Bajaj Allianz Life in general. Sure. And because he was managing investments, we used to get a lot of balance sheets of various companies like Hindustan Lever and Procter & Gamble at home.
Sure.
And also all the global financial magazines like Fortune and Wall Street Journal. That kindled an interest in equities in both me and my younger brother Arvind right since a young age.
Sure.
So after we finished our Chartered Accountancy and Cost Accountancy, both of us trained with a firm called Khandwala Equities in Bombay.
Yes.
And started with equity broking in Pune in 97-98. The journey was very good till 2000-2001. In 2000, we had a very large market crash led by the IT companies.
Yes.
And volumes dried up very sharply. That led us to think that we should also have diversification into other financial assets and other financial related fields. And we started two companies then. One was called Otus Insurance Broking, which between then to 2018 scaled up to India's second largest broking firm in the health insurance space.
Lovely.
We sold that to a large European broking firm called JLT and subsequently to Marsh. And the other firm we started in 2003 was the mutual funds distribution space. These were two. We felt that this would be a good way to diversify, and also it was complementary to what our clients were doing.
Sure.
Both general insurance and mutual funds.
Okay.
That's how we started.
So it's 18 years of Otus. What has been the key milestones when which you have come to this level where today you are managing 800 families? So how would you describe that journey to me?
One of my key themes was that we will build a very strong team. And from day one, I have never owned a single client, however large he is. So our largest client is close to around 100 crores, but even him I didn't own. It was always a team member who owned the client.
Sure.
And I was around to help the team member if required.
Okay.
So it's been a very team-oriented effort. What helped us was our very good understanding of equities. So we had already built a very good track record in equities and hold these stocks for clients. So we were able to create good alpha through equities for our clients. And then suddenly told our clients that equity mutual funds also need to occupy a space in their portfolios. They were quite open to what we were saying.
Right.
So we, that goodwill that we had built through equities helped us build our mutual fund business. So 2003 to 2008 was a very good run because the markets were doing well and mutual funds also did very well. But we made some significant mistakes in that period.
Okay.
One is that because mid caps were doing well, we went overweight in mid caps. And we also did some infrastructure related themes, which were the fashion then.
Yes.
And 2008 was a very rude shock. We also failed to invest adequately in debt. So our clients' portfolios were heavily lopsided into equities. Again, in equities, we had more of mid caps than large caps, and also some infrastructure theme. So 2008 was a rude shock, and we realized that we had done a very bad job in terms of asset allocation. Our clients' portfolios typically were almost, by 2008, they were 80-85% equity and only 10-15% debt. That led us to strictly make a firm decision that asset allocation was going to drive us henceforth, and we were not going to do any theme-based investing, and also not run with the momentum. And within mid-cap, large-cap also have a good mix of mid-cap, large-caps. So those mistakes led to the foundation for being a much better advisor. So now today we are almost like 55% debt, 40% equity. And we also ensured that because I was very biased towards equities, I tried to impose my biases on also my clients. So my father, who is 77 now, his portfolio is 100% equities. My portfolio is 100% equities, has always been 100% equities. And our strong conviction equities, we tried to impose on our clients. And that led to their portfolio also being lopsided. But that was a very important lesson for us. And after that, we have continued to build the debt part. And because of that, in this fall, in 2020, our clients were much better positioned. So broadly, they were like 45, 55 equity debt, 50 equity debt. So the pain was much lower. And also this time, going into this time, our portfolios also were mainly large cap focused. We got out of mid cap mainly in 2018. So the pain was much lower.
Fair.
And our background in equities also helped us to do a better job on alpha creation. We have historically have had a rule of not investing with more than 5 mutual funds at a time.
Okay.
And not investing in more than 12 schemes at a time. So that has also got a lot of focus and rigor to the whole process. So we also make it a point to ensure that we visit all the fund managers in Bombay at least once a quarter and meet the fund manager of each scheme that we are managing. And we also try to have monthly con calls.
I think it's a lovely process, at least that it's very, that you had learned from your mistakes to put asset allocation and constant review as a part of the process, to look at 5 AMCs or 12 schemes and just stick to it, the asset allocation. So I wanted to now come to your other part, which is your active part on the on your hobbies of traveling. How does that has helped you in your investments business?
Don't know if it has helped me in a big way, but I think that when you travel through Europe and the US, it helps you pick up themes a little earlier. For example, because of my traveling, I realized that, and also because I read the global financial newspapers, like I read the file, I've been reading the Wall Street Journal and the Financial Times for over now 20 years. So that helped me pick up themes like IT much earlier than other investors. I could see how the world was moving towards technology. So maybe I think that was one advantage of traveling very aggressively.
Sure.
And because I have not been managing clients, it has also given me much more time to travel. And when you travel, you also get a lot of time to think. So when I'm hiking the Himalayas for around 2 weeks every year, or I'm cycling, that also gives you much much more time to think. And also it ensures that our team members have to take decisions on their own. Generally, if someone comes to me asking for a solution, I generally don't give any answers. I ask them what in their opinion are 3 good options and let them take the decisions. I rarely take any decisions. So being out also makes them take decisions on their own. They can't come back to me asking me for help. They have to take it on their own.
Very interesting part.
And when I'm out, I never get a call from my team members. Unless no one ever calls me in those 100 days.
Lovely. So, sir, it's been now, you have seen the markets from 97, as you said, from trading, and then when you started the wealth management thing, you have seen a lot of regulations changing. So what has been your view on the regulations changing? How has it helped your business?
So I think all the regulations have only helped our business. When they stopped the entry load, I think that was something that helped us very a lot, because it ensured that we were thinking longer term, that it helped us to move our whole business towards trail. Also, this MFD versus RIA, I think we are not too perturbed about it. And we are also planning to float an entity or start an RIA division. Also, I think distributors who want to do both, it can push them to get together and form an entity and then have two divisions within that. I think most regulations have only helped us to get better. So I'm not too perturbed about regulation.
Fair. So my last question is, with your so many years of experience, what would you advise people who would look at this as a profession at the future, especially in the light of nowadays uncertainties because of COVID?
I don't think COVID has been a negative in any way, because during COVID, we found that our interaction with the client has only gone to a much higher plane. We ensured that we kept very close touch with our clients, and we found that because of COVID, our physical meetings went down sharply, our travel time went down sharply, and so we were able to increase our productivity by almost 34 to 40%, and clients were quite receptive to doing Zoom calls. So I think actually it has only been a boon in disguise, and because we were anyway using technology, it has been a very seamless transformation. Also, what we found is that clients which we onboarded after 2008, some of them said that they were all right with volatility, and they said that we could be 80% equity, 20% debt. But only during this fall, we were able to test that client's psyche. And we found out that there's a big gap between what some clients are saying and how they're able to deal with this volatility. So these 3-4 months have also given us a good chance to rebalance our portfolios for clients. People were not able to handle volatility as well as they thought they could. So a lot of portfolios we could rebalance, we've used to rebalance in this last 3-4 months. So I think it has only been a boon in disguise. It has helped us to get closer to our clients. We have interacted very closely with them and also reallocated their assets. Another important thing we have been doing is that we have been also adding international equities as asset class to the portfolio of our clients. And I've been seeing very closely how they have been working in the US and Europe. It has been my belief that some of the best companies that we use daily and to whose bottom line we contribute very strongly are outside India. And I think it's very important to have these global assets as a part of our asset allocation. And during this fall, we felt that this shift from physical to digital will get accelerated. So we added NASDAQ as a constant to our portfolios very aggressively in this fall. That has been another important rebalancing that we've done to portfolios this fall, this year.
So lovely thought. I think, as you said, asset allocation, whether it is within asset classes or geographical, makes sense. So it should always be a part of the portfolio. So thank you, Ajay sir. I think my learning from this interaction is two crashes which we have seen, 2008 and 2020 uncertainty. Both times you mentioned that during both the times, one led you towards a better asset allocation, not impose your own risk profiling to the investors, which is a very strong statement to make as a wealth manager, that you were able to segregate your risk profile and the investor's risk profile and use this 2020 to understand client psyche. And it's a lovely thought. I think it's a big learning for anybody who's viewing this episode. These are my takeaways, I'm sure. But thank you so much. We really value your association with Mirae Asset. And thank you for taking out time for doing this. Thank you, viewers. So thank you, Ajay sir, for taking out time. Thank you for sharing your thoughts about the business and how, what is your process, and giving us an insight into that. Thank you, viewers, for watching another interesting episode of The Big Leap from Mirae Asset. And we look forward to bringing these stories again in the future. So thank you, Ajay sir, again. Thank you for your time. Thank you, viewers.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.